We're going to have some more demonstrations in a moment. I'll go back to that photograph that I showed you before. I just want to zoom in on these two for a minute. Okay. If you look at his face, he's 11 years old. He looks like he's enjoying himself, doesn't he? And 11-year-olds, they're not normally that pally with girls of the same age. They don't normally have much to do with it, but they're supporting each other. They're helping each other. And I didn't say to them, "Hey, can you two do this just for the photograph?" They're sharing it. They love it. These kids, everything's all about, oh, Facebook, oh, my toast has dropped on the floor, or this. So they love sharing things. And whatever the future's going to be, it's going to be all about sharing. It's not going to be Alan O'Donoghue goes home at the weekend, spends the whole weekend reading this, comes into school, does some stuff. It's not about a person on their own. It's all about sharing. And that's why I'm trying to share and get as much out there as possible. So that's the end of my slides. Now I'm going to do another demonstration. So this is a bit of a challenge. I'm going to show you how quick it is to make a game in about 3 minutes. Okay. So, using Scratch. So, I'm going to go to... Hands up if you have used Scratch before yourself. Anybody here who has used Scratch? So, at the moment, we've got two people in the room who have. Is there anybody in the room who would like to use Scratch? Who would like to do this? Two, three, four, five, six. So, we've got two who have, six who would like to. Hopefully I'm going to change that, so say no to that one. Okay, so Scratch, you have a menu. It's a visual thing. You drop stuff in here. This is your scripts for the sprites, and this is your display area. And you can make it go full screen like this to see what it looks like. So this is how you make a game in 3 minutes. So time starts. So right, first thing is, the cat, I don't have anything personal against cats, I'm just not using a cat for this game. I'm going to make a racing car game, I don't need this sensitive thing at the moment. So, I'm going to create a new sprite. This new sprite is going to be a racing car. So, I'm going to do a Formula One racing car, I'm going to be looking down on it from above. So, it doesn't look much like a car, so let me put some tires on it. Let's just choose the color black. So, rear tire, ooh, they're not quite the right size as each other. Front wheels, still doesn't look much like a car. Okay, let's put a spoiler on the back, like Formula One cars have, and then like a front spoiler, something like that. Still not looking much like a car, right? Let's put a racing car driver in it. So he's got a white helmet on, and oh, we'll put a number on the front of the car. And I use a paintbrush, and what I'm going to do, I'm going to put lucky number 7. So car's number 7. Okay, so there's our racing car. So I click on OK. So what I can do now is I can, using the mouse, I can drag it around the screen, but when I click on the green flag, the car does nothing. It's not been given any instructions or prompts. So now I need to tell it what to do. So I go up to my script menu, and the thing I'm going to say is, when I click on the green flag next time, what I needed to do was move forward. So into the motion menu, move 10 steps. So click on the green flag. That's not going to get your average 11-year-old excited. So I need to make it move a little bit faster, continually move. So I'm going to say forever move forward 10 steps. Okay, and now the car's gone off the screen. So bring it back on. Oh, it's just going to keep doing that. So now what I need to do is I need to tell it, when you get to the edge of the screen, come back again. So I can put in a little thing that says, if on edge, bounce back. I think it's in motion, and the thing is, you can find loads of stuff in there that you've never used before. So now I'll click on the green flag, so it bounces off the edge of the screen. The car's a bit big, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to shrink the car so it fits okay like that. And now I'll click on the green flag. Okay, so I've got the car bouncing around the screen. Now I need to give it the ability to move. So I'm going to say, when you click on the green flag, oh, no, ditch that. When I press a certain key, the right arrow key, it's going to change direction by clockwise 15 degrees. And I'm going to duplicate that. And I'm going to do it so it's just the left arrow. No, anti-clockwise. So now, watch, I can steer it around the screen. Could do donuts as well. Okay? So what are we on about? That's 2 minutes. Right. So I've got 1 minute left to make it look like a game. So I'm going to give it I need a background for the track, so quick way, green, failed, this is just like using paint. I need to put a track on there, I'm going to use a big fat white brush, whoa, too big, needs to be a little degree of challenge in this game. Right, just changing the brush size. And now I'm going to put in a track that goes all the way around the game. And now let me go. Oh, I made a mistake. I should have done, not a sprite, I should have done it as the stage, the background. So I'll do that again. So edit, bucket, green, fill, track, paint, big brush, white. So there's our track. And now, when I go full screen, I can click on the green flag and wait, do you know, it's going too fast, so let me just reduce the speed of the car. Instead of 10 steps, let's make it 2 steps. So green flag, and now, I'm going to shut up for 3 minutes. I bet you wish I'd said that earlier. And I want you to think of now things that I could add to the game to enhance the playing experience. So talk to somebody next to you for 3 minutes. What can I do to add to this game to make it more enjoyable for the player? Left. Five, four, three, two, one. Okay, we're going to stop now. So, what would you like to add to the game? Make it better.
Sound.
We'll do that in a moment. Okay. Hello, Mr. Vasily.
Yes. Hi. We're thinking different things. Like, one is to collect points. Like, if something would appear on the screen and you drive over it.
So it's an incentive to drive around the track.
And okay. Also increase the difficulty. Like, perhaps go faster, slowly faster as time increases.
So okay.
Competing element.
So it builds up in complexity. Yes, you raised your eyebrow. What would you like to suggest?
Weapons.
Brilliant, yes. So you can fire stuff out the front. Okay, gentleman in the grey top.
Sunshine,
and how would that work?
Well, just change the colours.
Ah, so you can actually have, you can do that, you can build scripts in, so change the background and change the colour of the car as you move along. Cameraman?
Another car.
Another car? So we have a two-player game.
Yeah.
Martin?
Skid marks.
Skid marks. Jeremy?
Holes in the road to dodge.
Okay. Now, this is when I do this with an 11-year-old class, year 7, they're all saying, you could add in pills, like you're saying, so you have to collect these pills, but you could have bad pills as well, like evil pills. So you're collecting the good pills, but then you have to avoid a bad pill, because otherwise it wipes out all of your score. So two players, but one car occasionally speeds up and you don't know which one it is. They want to build in like subterfuge for some reason. They want to make it hard for people. Sounds, they say, can I put, you know, Beyonce in there? Yeah, you can put in whatever you want. We tend to think there's been straight lines, some of us, but the kids. So I can just show you quickly how to add one of those features in. But what would be better is if I invite somebody up to come to the front and try and build in one of these. So. Have you used Scratch before?
Nope.
Oh, great, perfect. So, which of those features are you going to add in?
Can I look through, go up through the menu first?
Yeah. We've got motion, looks, sound, sensing, operators, variables, control.
I'm going to add going faster or slower.
Oh, good. See?
So, I'm going to say, instead of moving in 2 steps, I'm going to have for this sprite, only call it.
What's your name?
Andrew.
Andrew. Imagine if Andrew came away from this event today thinking, I've never used Scratch before. Gosh, my neighbour's got kids, or my sister-in-law has got three children. I could show them how to do it. And then those three children, they then go and show somebody else how to do it. That's what I'm trying to do, create ripples so that people... You can pick a lot of this up. It's quite straightforward. It's free to download. It will run on any platform. So if you're lucky enough to have a Raspberry Pi next week, you can run Scratch on it. If you've got a Mac or a Linux machine or a PC, some of you probably have one of those. I've not tried it on the BBC B yet, because I haven't got a BBC B. But maybe with some... Can you get a PC emulator for the BBC?
I've heard you
play. Yeah. Yeah. So you've actually got a control to control the speed.
Yeah.
So go for it. Has anybody ever been to a coding dojo? No? This is kind of what happens at coding dojo. People shout stuff, no, you did it wrong, no, you need to add this in, and
can make you get backwards.
Whoa, skid marks. That's what we need now. Okay, give them a round of applause. Hello, could you come and add a feature into the game, please? So, if you're in full screen mode and you want to come out, press escape. And if you go on YouTube or Google or any of these things and type in Scratch, you'll find there's hundreds of tutorials, there's videos, there's screencasts. What are you going to add in?
I was thinking about sound.
Okay.
I was thinking about reading glasses.
So, can we have a navigator to help us? So somebody step forward as a navigator. Space Invaders, ma'am. Is it Pac-Man? Space Invaders, go and help him. Be his navigator for us. What's probably itching you is you're probably sitting there thinking, I know how to do this, I know what to tell them how to do it. Is anybody thinking that? Don't hold your tongue, shout at them, tell them what you can do.
We need another one of these if on edge.
You're being too polite, shout at them. Sorry.
I'm going to do if on the edge, play a drum sound, I think.
Oh, that's going to be a tricky one. I'd go for an easier one if I were you. Like, just have it play a sound as the car's moving forward.
You can make, and you can say, loud in the variable again to change the speed. It's loud and speed up.
Sounds like it's a single stroke engine or two strokes. I do have lessons sometimes where I hear that noise a lot from the wall.
Have you tried this with teachers who've perhaps done what is now become traditional ICT, the Word and PowerPoint and whatever else? What sort of reception do you get? Do you get someone who's completely fazed by it, I can't possibly do that, or is it generally a very, very positive?
There's three groups. There's right. A group of teachers who can come in and sort of, yeah, I've been using for ages, I can do this, no problem. And sometimes they're a bit too confident and they get stuck.
Yeah.
Then there's some that go, oh, I wouldn't even know where to start. Mm-hmm. And they go, I feel like I'm a programmer now, I can do this. And then there's a group of people in the middle that kind of will go with whichever one of those other groups that they feel. So yeah. They'll either go, or they'll go, oh no, it's too hard. But it's a confidence thing, you know, to get up in front of a lot of people and show them what you're doing. It's,
yes.
By having nothing at all, and allowing people just to allow it to evolve and to develop. They're saying that, like, talk about having a wiki curriculum where people come in and add stuff in and build it out in different places. Some people say that's the wrong thing. This clearly presents a problem because you've got teachers like myself who are enthusiastic. I don't have a computer science background. I from the age of 10 to 15, I had a BBC, Spectrum, ZX81, did all this sort of stuff. Done nothing about it since. A year ago, I decided I was going to do this. So I've taught myself programming in Python. I discovered all these things through Twitter and all this and sharing it all with people.
It's that on the edge.
Started today, I showed you, it kind of failed a little bit, our happy birthday BBC. Well, I've got a racing car game where you can have sound in it. But the sound, it's not an output, it's an input. Okay, so I'm going to pick on somebody in the audience in a moment. Now, if you notice, as I'm talking, if I get really loud, at least the numbers go up quite high. But when I stop talking, or go quiet, it drops down to zero. So I thought, what about if you had a game that its speed was dependent on how loud the person was playing it? So that, for example, a green flag, so it starts moving, but if I go, like that, or to work in some other what I did, I was too loud this morning, I must have had too much coffee, so I had to divide it by four to reduce it, so now I'll just change that to one, just which negates the divide.
Set a slider sensor by the bottom.
Ah, yes. So I have a slider sensor, and I can speed that up quite a lot, or I can slow it right down. There's a linear potentiometer on this Pico board thing, so you can actually go full screen, just so you can see what's happening. So I can slow it right down, or I can speed it up. But now you're right. Well done for spotting that, young man. I'm going to change it now to sound. So as I go, So now I'm going to pick on a volunteer from the audience. The guy with the stripy shirt sat at the back. You thought I wasn't going to pick you. Now you said you've used Scratch before. You don't have to say anything. You just come to the front. We just need your fingers to do this. To control the car. Okay, so I'm going to hide this sensor because it's a bit of a distraction at the moment. Now, the car is set to move forward two steps, and now the audience, we're going to be mean. We're going to make car noises. So go on, do it. So you could have. I have a YouTube channel where I put stuff on, like this video crashing today, but I've done one with a pong game where I got the audience to play against each other to control the bats. So you can play fair, so that you shout and the bat moves to the left or to the right, whatever. Or when the other team are playing, you can be mean and you can go like this, okay? But there's all sorts of interesting things. You can have it so you dip it in water, or you can have a panel over here with wires and throw sponges. And you have to throw sponges at him to make his car go faster. There's loads of stuff that kids come up with these. You can have it so it's a light sensor, so as you cover it or move away, and just let kids' imagination take over. You're liking this, aren't you?
Yes, can't take it off.
So, that's it. I'm supposed to finish at 4:30. I've got 3 minutes to go. Thank you for listening. Sorry, a couple of postscripts. Girls into computing. Sophie said earlier she was surprised to hear it was as much as 15% that were going to on a museum trip. I'm doing as much as I can, but there seems to be a crucial age, which is when children get to girls, about 12 going to 13, they come quite polarized so I'll give you an example. So I had a class of 11, 12-year-olds, and I did a programming task with them, and I said to them, people say girls are no good at computing, but we're going to prove them wrong. And we did. We proved them wrong. It was like, first 5 people to do it, and the girls all did it first. So I'm like, yay, girls, go girls, you know. Can the boys beat them? So positive encouragement is one thing. The other thing I mentioned before was having other positive female role models. You know, I showed you the girl who was the BBC developer, getting people like that to come into school. You might have seen during our Hack the Future event, we had Samantha Bale, a scientist from the University of Manchester. So that's one thing that really, really makes a difference. Raspberry Pi, what a fantastic initiative that brings so many people together, like the BBC did 30 years ago. If you go to the National Museum of Computing, there's a room you can go in, like a library. I met Tony Sale in there once. And even in this room, there's a bookshelf that runs from there to there. And it's got individual copies of, I don't know, 200 or 300 books, all to do with do this with the BBC Micro, plug this into it, plug that in. Maybe the Raspberry Pi might help ignite that kind of thing all over again. Children love artificial intelligence. They all want an iPhone 4S with Siri on it. I've shown them how in Python you can build up pseudo-artificial intelligence. And everybody's saying, Cambridge, yay, computing history. don't forget Manchester has also got a very, very strong computing heritage as well. And I'm from Dublin. Okay. But thank you for listening. Okay.